But you stay clean for the next 4 years, he said, I'll tear this rap sheet up. But you violated it one time. You understand? He said the deal is off. And here's a police officer who could send this man to jail for 8 to 10 years for some stuff that he did. He was guilty of doing that. And he gave him a reprieve. He said, now if you go straight now for the next 4 years, although you have a thick rap sheet, I'll destroy it. You won't do it in time. The young man made a promise that he was going to go straight. So the officer put his rap sheet folded to his desk, and the young man walked out of prison. Now, that was then. We don't know what happened in the next 4 years because they go that far ahead. How many times have God forgiven us for something? And we said to God, God forgive me this one time. I'm never going to do it again. Are y'all feeling the same? How many times have we made God promise? God, if you just forgive me one more time, get me out of this problem one more time, I promise you, God. I swear, God, I'll never do it again. And no sooner as God says, okay. Everybody hear what I'm going? Here's what Jesus is saying. Jesus is saying, I'm going to make you a deal. If you want redemption from all your sin, your past, your present, and your future, pick up your cross and follow me there. That's the deal. If you want to be saved, if you want that new home in glory, if you want redemption, all you have to do is to pick up your cross daily and follow me. Doesn't matter how thick your rap sheet is, how long it is, doesn't matter what you've done in your past, doesn't matter what you're even doing right now, doesn't matter who you hate, who you dislike, who you're mad at, who you're going to curse out, all the stuff you've done, he said, I'll wipe your plate clean right now.
Come on,
brother. All you got to do, pick up your cross and follow me. Now, but then he says, for whosoever does not bear his cross and come of me cannot be my disciple. He isn't saying like the officer said to the young man, I make you a deal. What are you saying? This is the deal. The Israelites, God chose the people, have made God so many promises that they didn't keep. And sometimes we read about that, matter of fact, Sunday school this morning. But how they made God promises, and God in His grace and His mercy forgive them. But every time they come out of something, they violate God's word again. And I wonder if you and I, who have been given so many opportunities to go straight, to go do the right thing, how many times have we failed God on His word? Are you okay with me? Cross bearing comes with a lot of if. Now go back to our text scripture in verse number 26 of 14 of Luke. If any man, that means mankind, so don't think, well, he didn't say woman. He said man. So, Caleb She should skip this right. Janet should skip it right because she's not a woman. So it says, any man or woman come at me and hates not his father and mother and wife, children and brother and sister, even his own life. Mm-hmm. Also, he cannot be my disciple. Is that what your Bible says? This is why you need to come by saying. Because you don't even know what you just got there reading. I'll come this late on. Now, go with me, hold that, but go with me to Matthew chapter number 8. I'll be here in about 15 minutes. Matthew chapter number 8. And let me share this with you too as well. Because if you think that's bad, this is worse. See, we pick out some good stuff to read from the Bible. All the blessings. God will bless you coming, bless you going out. And you can head not to tell you're blessed in the city, you're blessing the country, huh? But God said there's some stuff that you got to do also to get the blessing.
That's right.
I can do all things through Christ who strengthened me. Oh yeah, we saw the nice thing. But there's some stuff to get too that you really don't want to hear. And this is one of them that even worse than what I just got to read.
Come on.
In Matthew chapter 8, verses 19 through 22. Watch this now. And a certain scribe came and said to him, Master, I will follow you whichever you go with. And we're saying that too. How many times you say God? Lord, be somebody, hear my sending. But look at the next verse. And Jesus said to him, the foxes have holes. Birds of the air have nests. But the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. He's gone from nowhere now to a mansion. He said, I go away to prepare you a place. And if I go away, I will come again to receive unto myself that where I am, there you may be also. But he said in the heart with him, the birds, foxes have holes. Birds have nests. I have a way to lay my head. Now watch this now. And another of the disciples said to him, Lord, suffer me, allow me, let me first to go bury my father. His father died. I will follow you, but let me go and bury my father first. Look what he says here. And Jesus said to him, follow me. Let the dead bury the dead. Is that cold? This is one of the hottest scriptures in the Bible, unless you understand what he's saying. Mm-hmm. Are you really ready to be his disciple? Are you really ready to follow Jesus? He said, anyone company that doesn't hate his mother, his father, his brother, his sister, his wife, husband, even your own life, you can't be my disciple. Then it says here, follow me and let the dead bury the dead.
Come on, man.
The cost of discipleship means you must be willing to give up everything that interfere with you following the Lord. Not some things, but everything. Not the easy one, but anything that stands between you and God. What are you willing to give up or to follow the Lord? Following Christ is more than a word, more than a saying. It's meaning that when I make up my mind to follow Christ, I can't even turn back.
All right.
I can't even look back. I can't even back. I won't turn back. I will not go back. I will not look back. In my bad days, in my good days, sad days, or cloudy days, in my valley, whatever day may come, I will not turn back. some things are hard to accept them out. Sometimes, ladies and gentlemen, if you got to give up some stuff you've been holding to for so long that caused you not to follow Christ. That old boyfriend you've had for 10 years won't make a decision to marry you. That girlfriend that you've been living with and won't, she don't want to get married. That job that's going nowhere, but you're afraid to give it up because. And what's happened sometimes, God said, I want you to give it up so I can give you a husband. That I can give you a wife. But once you hold someone who won't commit to you, guess what? You'll cause your harm to yourself and anything else. God wants to give you something better, but you want something worse. You got to take yourself, I ain't going back. That's just behind me. Burn your little black book. Burn the bridges. Tell him, tell her, I will not compromise my integrity to please you. If you don't want to commit, get the stepping like Mark said.
That's yes, all right.
Let's go hit you. Well.
Yes.
Now, before you go away mad, let me explain these verses to you. Is that all right?
Yes.
In Luke, when Jesus said, Peter, a man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brother and sister, even his own, cannot be my disciple. I don't care how much you love him or her, she, he. What are you saying here? That you cannot put nobody before him. He doesn't even hate the sense of detest or dislike. He's saying that nothing can be so important to you that you put anybody or anything before him.
That's what he's
saying. On the surface, this seems hard to do. Why would he say, hate your mother, your father, brother, brother, sister? He's talking about what they put before him. What we worship. What's more important to us. So you can't put nobody before him, nobody in front of him, nobody behind him, nobody outside of him. He must have first place in our lives. In other words, when you follow, you must love me more than your own father, than your own wife, than your own husband, than your own son, than your own daughter, the grandchildren, those cats and dogs, everybody else. So don't use that word hate as being dislike. Alright? It simply means that you must love him more than anything. That job cannot come before God. This church cannot come before God. That wife and husband and father cannot come before him. Now, I didn't say go over to your husband. Don't get me in no trouble. That come down and won't suit me. So all you got a wife and husband at home, don't go home and say what the pastor said. I gotta hate you. And that's not what the pastor's saying.
All right.
Make sure you got this on tape too, my brother D. That's, you see, salvation is supposed to be free, is it not? But salvation costs something. Because you got to give some stuff in order to be happy, get salvation. Like Jesus gave his life for us to be free. But just that there's a lot of if my people who can call my name, come on and pray and seek my faith, turn from the wicked way. He said, then I'm going to hear from heaven. If you abide in me, my word abide in you. time we put everything before or in front of God, and God get what we have left over. That's not how God operates. Huh? You tell me that Jesus don't even want me to do nothing? And what about with the dead carry dead? Is he saying to you, Henry, you should take time to bury your loved ones? You should grieve over them? I thought God was love. We're preaching the high cost of discipleship.
That is right.
Discipleship means more than coming to church on Sunday through hours.
There you go.
It means more than singing a couple songs in the choir. It means more than playing the piano, beat drums. It means more than reading a few scriptures, saying a couple prayers, saying hallelujah, lift your hand and say thank you, Jesus. Discipleship means I'm willing to disobey everything and obey what God says me to do.
Amen. Yeah, come on now.
Because discipleship is about obedience to the Lord Jesus Christ.
Oh, yeah, preacher.
Follow me, let the dead bury the dead. He's not saying you can't celebrate a person's life. Or something that you love. Huh? But what are you saying here to me? Jesus has more concern about the living than about the dead.
That's good.
Come on.
We celebrate, and we ought to celebrate. Mm-hmm. But a lot of times, we do more for dead folks. Mm-hmm. You see where I'm going? Then we do more for living folks. Are y'all feeling? When they pass away, we talk about how great they were, how nice they were, and what wonderful thing they did. Nothing wrong with that. But what I say the same word to a lady first once in a while. You're nice, you're beautiful, you're kind, you're chap. Don't wait till they can't hear nothing. We make them a saint when they might be an ant. They're with the Lord now. You don't know where they are. I'm still hoping and trusting that I can make it easy. I don't know where they're going. I can say, this one there, this one her life. I'm leaving this there, but I don't know that because I haven't been there yet. We have this long, drawn-out service sometimes. I see sort of like 3 or 4 days. You get funeralized, you get funeralized, then you get funeralized, something like that. Everybody in the world come. But as a believer, the Bible says to be absent from the body. Be in prayer with the Lord.
Yes.
Now, what is he saying here? Father, let the dead bury the dead. He's saying, celebrate and move on. Because the usual is a celebration. He says, celebrate, watch this now. And let those who are spiritually dead, those who do not know the Lord, let them keep on what they're doing anyway.
Yes.
But you celebrate that life and you move on. Now, I know, please, I'm going to get in trouble with this. You know, I'm just reading what the Bible says. Now, I'm just trying to explain to you my best I can what the verse means. I make folks mad sometimes. Now, how? You give 2 minutes to happy remarks, they're going to take 20. But what they are saying should have been said with perfectly lie. You and I need to understand and remember the demand of discipleship is costly. And know that God will test us in our relationship to prove that we are following Jesus is our highest priority. Didn't you know the Lord that you heard? Didn't you know that you're sad? Didn't you know you're sad when somebody that you love passed on? But here's what he's trying to get across to us. Do all you can while they're still alive.
All right.
And once they're gone, celebrate their life and then move on. Because see, the Bible speaks of that there are 2 fathers in the earth. You know that, right? There are 2 fathers in the earth. their God who is not Father. Mm-hmm. And there's Satan who's also a father, but not a believer. Mm-hmm. Now, you can either follow which father are you following? Like one commercial, someone says, "Who's your dad?" And a lot of us don't realize this too, but God is supposed to be your father. But sometimes he's not our father. It's the other person who is our father. And I can prove it from the Bible. See, y'all like these good messages, make you shout, make you jump around, son.
All right.
The truth shall make you free, right?
Yes, we do.
And you can sum up anybody's theology in about 5-6 words. How you do that? Jesus, good.
Yes.
Sinner is bad.
Yes.
Jesus, true.
Yes.
Sinner, liar. Now let's prepare to close. In John chapter number 8, turn that for a second. John chapter 8. See, Satan can't tell the truth because there's no truth in him. He put thoughts in your mind, in your head. He called you to do things that none of you shouldn't be doing. Well, let me show you here now. There's your father in the earth. I don't have time to break this down. I don't want to, but just give you a little tip of which you have time to go home and read a little more. The devil is the father of lies. He's not capable of telling the truth. John chapter number 8, verse 41. You do the deeds of your father. Don't the Bible say? Then they said to him, "We're not born of fornication," meaning that we're not born out of wedlock. They said, "Our father's God." Jesus said to them, "If God were your father, you would love me. For I have come from God, nor have I come of myself, but he sent me. Why do you not understand my speech? Because you're not able to listen to my words." Now this verse 44 now. You are of your father who?
The
devil. And the desire what you love more than God, what you do and desire more than him, what it said here too. And the desire of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning. And he does not stand in the truth. That's what I said, right?
Yeah.
Because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources. For he is a liar and the father of it. But because I tell the truth, you don't believe me. Now, is my name there too? Anything that Satan says is a lie. He cannot tell the truth. There's no truth in him. He's incapable of telling the truth. How does Satan operate? He puts the thoughts in your mind. He tells you, "That's all right. Do this, do that. Say this, say that. Go there, go here. Do this, do that." Put the thoughts in your mind. Put a thought in your mind, guess what? You start questioning what the word says.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.